Welcome to Twickenham. Glad you're here. Thanks for coming out to be with us today. If you are a guest, we are honored to have you here. Thank you for coming. There's a card on the seat in front of you, and whether you're a member or a guest, we'd love for you to indicate any prayer requests you have. We will absolutely be praying about those. You know, you guys over here are doing a great job. Y'all need to bring some more friends over here. What do we got? Sheep and goats? What's going on here, right? If you're looking for a church, we are looking for new family members. We'd love to talk with you about how we can begin this journey together. So we're just glad you're here. Thanks for coming out. I know that it has been a really hard week around the planet, particularly down on the southeastern coast of the U.S., Haiti, hundreds killed. You may have relatives down in Florida, Georgia, South Carolina that suffered loss. So it's been a bad week in that regard. I also know that politically, it's just kind of a mess out there, right? And I don't know whether you're a Republican or a Democrat, but either way, right now, wow, it's just awful. It's just a mess. So on days like this, when we're coming off of a week where there's been such just struggle And that's not even talking about the personal things we're going through. Songs like the one we just sang are so important, okay? Because what we're saying is, whether we are in a season of abundance or a spiritual, financial, relational, personal drought, we're going to praise the Lord. Because the Lord is on his throne no matter what else is happening, right? And not everything is bad. Alabama won yesterday. Auburn won yesterday. Georgia didn't lose. We lose today, right? So it's not all bad. And somebody we've been praying about for weeks is actually here today. I'm not going to ask her to stand because it's a little, it's better if she sits. But Carolyn Lewis is here this morning. So why don't you give her a hand? We're glad to have her. Let's all stand together. Let's all stand together. And we're going to praise the Lord this morning louder and louder. And the worse things are, the louder we're going to get. Let's praise him together.
There's a song that cannot be contained. There's a shout that breaks through every chain. God, we won't be silent. There's a faith that rises through the flames. There's a joy that chases the dark away. God, we won't be silent. And the greater the storm, the louder our song. We lift our voices, make your praise so glorious, glorious. We lift our voices, make your praise so glorious. There's a faith that rises through the flames. There's a joy that chases the dark away. God, we won't be silent. And the greater the storm, the louder our song. We lift our voices, make your praise so glorious, glorious. We lift our voices, make your praise so glorious. We'll never stop singing, we'll never stop singing, we'll never stop singing, we'll never stop singing. We lift our voices, make your praise so glorious, glorious. We lift our voices.
Lord.
restores me again. So I lift my eyes to you, Lord. In your strength will I break through, Lord. Touch me now. Let your love fall down on me, and I
for us.
Because God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in them. This is how love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. In this world, we are like Jesus. There is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out fear. Because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love.
We love because he first loved us.
Let's take our offering.
Faithful love flowing down from the thorn-covered crown makes me whole, saves my soul, washes whiter than snow. Faithful love calms each fear, reaches down, dries each tear, holds my hand when I can't stand on my own. Faithful love from above came to earth to show the Father's love. And I'll never
seems to end, welcome face, sweet embrace, tender time. One of my favorite parables is the prodigal son in Luke 15. Recall the prodigal son taking the inheritance, going far away and living in sin, and the elder son near but reticent to go into celebration when the prodigal son returns. Remember the father loving them both and going out to them both, drawing them into relationship. I want to contrast two ways of seeing the Father in this parable. One, in a Rembrandt, painted in 1665. In it, we see the younger son in tattered clothes, kneeling before his father very proper, magnificently dressed, who is standing in the midst of family and friends, also very proper and honorable. In contrast to this picture, I relate to you some notes from the journal of Professor Kenneth Bailey. Kenneth Bailey was a missionary who recently shared the gospel in Middle Eastern Arab communities. Unlike the culture of Rembrandt or our American culture, these Middle Eastern communities are much more similar to that of Jesus, one where honor and shame are of primary importance. Professor Bailey notes in his journal, after hearing this parable, these people did not ask, was it legal or illegal for the younger son to sell the land and move to another country with the money? Their question was, how could a son bring such shame on himself and his family? But the biggest surprise of all was their reaction from the part of the story where the father ran to meet his returning son. His hearers responded in amazement. The father too? Would he also bring shame on himself? How's that? Bailey asked. Because an old man would not run. Why not? Asked Bailey, because he would have to lift up his robe and bring shame on himself. The prodigal son expected the people of the town to mock him, to laugh at him, to scorn him, to throw stones at him. But suddenly the people of the village see something totally unexpected. The father does something that will make him the laughingstock. He picks up his garment and runs. Suddenly the professor gained new insight, not only into this parable, but into the whole New Testament message of grace. This parable, through the lens of the missionary's journal, helps us see the reality of our Father. And so as we gather at the Lord's table, let us remember our Father loves us, and he is going out to us even now, reaching out his hand, whether we've been far away or standing just outside. Grace is a loving Father taking on our shame, taking us by the hand, and taking us back into relationship. As we eat this communion meal together, let us celebrate relationship with him and with our family. Let us pray. Father, we gather in the name of Jesus, remembering and celebrating the love you have for us, a love so vast that you go to great lengths, great shame, to bring us to commune with you today. Father, as we take this bread, we remember Jesus' broken body. Amen.
How sweet the name of Jesus sounds in a believer's ear. It soothes our sorrows, heals our wounds, and drives
Let us continue in prayer. Father, we remember Jesus on the cross, his blood poured out for us. Father, we praise you for the blood of the covenant and your wonderful grace. Father, help us to love as we have seen you love. Amen.
Bread of life, pure living water, lover of my soul. In my weakness, be my strength to reach the final goal. Lamb of God, dear. We believe in a God who is able to bring justice and mercy to all. And he promises strength for the journey to the steadfast who answer the call. Let us be faithful, 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 Lord. Let us be faithful, faithful, Lord. Though we cannot see, we still believe. Let us be faithful, faithful, Lord. We believe in the truth of the Bible, in its power and purpose today. There is meaning and life in its pages. We
Commercial here. In January of 2017, we're starting a new Jobs for Life class. Jobs for Life is a ministry that we're involved in that partners people that have struggled to find employment or have struggled to find employment that can help really meet their family's needs, with people who can help them with job interviews and just sort of professional skill training. And it's all done in an environment of Christian values and Christian conversations, and it's biblically oriented. So it's a really, really great ministry. And there are some powerful stories that have come out of our Jobs for Life ministry, folks that were unemployable and have moved on into positions and then been promoted and just really been able to become people that are able to support themselves and their families, and they've been drawn closer to Christ. You may have a gift that would benefit that. You guys can kind of scroll to the next few slides here. Some of us could teach in that ministry. There are some other things you could do, like encouraging food preparation, because they have dinner tonight. There's coaching and friendships that are developed through this ministry. So I would just encourage you to think about it. The next class begins in January. If you're interested, you can email JFL, that stands for Jobs for Life, JFL@twickenham.org, and they'll respond to you and get back to you on that with ways that you could be a part of that. Keep it in your prayers. And if you're not involved in anything right now, that would be a great thing for you to look at and consider getting involved in. Okay, it's a great, great ministry. I want you to look with me in Matthew chapter 25. Okay, Matthew chapter 25. Matthew's the first book in the New Testament, and that's where we're gonna be here in just a couple of minutes. When I was in the eighth grade, I was in love with a girl named Karen. It's not really her name, because it's really none of your business what her name is, right? So I was in love with her all year long. I mean, all year. From the day one, first day of class in eighth grade, until I just was in love. And I never told her. Never said a word to her. I played my cards very close to my vest. In fact, my cards were in a hermetically sealed canvas envelope wrapped in asbestos hidden inside my body. I never sent her a note that said, "I like you, do you like me, check one yes or no." I didn't do the back channel thing where I, tried to figure out through her best friend, whether she would have anything to do with me. I just did nothing. I mean, I was completely frozen in fear of rejection. The last week of school, okay, I've had this deep feeling all year, right? The last week of school, our class took a trip to Six Flags, and I managed to hang out with Karen and her best friend Shelley all day long. And I developed this plan in my head. I don't know how I was going to do it, but my plan was I was going to get rid of Shelley, the best friend, and then Karen and I would be we'd get on the Sky Bucket. You remember the Sky Bucket at Six Flags? It's been so long since I've been to Six Flags, I don't even know if they still have it. But it used to go, you'd get in this bucket, and it would go across the park. I was going to get on the bucket with Karen, and halfway across, I was going to tell her that I loved her. And she would either love me back or jump, So around 9 o'clock that night, Karen, and her best friend Shelley and I are walking by the front entrance when Karen all of a sudden says, "Well, I have to go. I'm meeting my mom here early, and I'm leaving early, and I'm going to a different school next year, so y'all don't forget me." And then she was gone. Out of my life. And it's a really good thing, because I met Lisa, and she's like way, way better, right? So I'm just devastated, because she's walking out of my life forever, and I'm just beside myself. So then her best friend, Shelly, and I get on the sky bucket, which is not how this was supposed to work out, right? And we're going across, and halfway across, I just blurted it out. I just said, "Oh, I've been in love with Karen all year long, and I never told her." And her best friend went, "Really? Because she's been in love with you all year long, too." So I jumped out of the sky bucket, right? Have you ever done anything like that, though? I mean, have you ever... There's something you really want to do. You want to do it, and you don't because you're afraid. You're scared about what will happen. Some of you in this room wanted to buy Microsoft when it was $21 a share in 1986, but did you? No, you didn't. You were afraid, or you bought just a little bit. This past Monday, Microsoft was trading at $58 a share, which doesn't sound like a lot, except you realize that it's split 9 times. Do you realize how much money you could have given to church, but you were afraid? We do stuff like that all the time. I think it's just the human condition. Fear freezes us. We have the intent to do something. There's the desire. We start to take a step. And then the fear hits us. What if it doesn't work? What if I blow it? What if I fail? What if people laugh at me? What if I make a mistake? What if? Fear freezes us. I bet everybody in this room can think of a time when fear stopped you in your tracks. If we were just to open up the mic and just say, "Come on up and share the story," we'd have a parade of people going across the stage. It's just the human condition. And I think it's one of the reasons we find it difficult to go deeper with God. We've been talking about that now for weeks, about how to develop a deeper relationship with God. And now this morning we're going to bring this series to a close. And in some ways we're going to end up pretty close to where we started, by remembering something about the God with whom we are invited to go deeper. Okay, so Matthew 25, that's where we're going to look. And Jesus tells this story about how fear is one of the things that can keep us from going deeper. And I'm going to tell you, this is a little bit of a long reading, so you got to work with me on this. Hang in there. It's a great story. But it's a little longer than normal. So we're going to start in verse 14 of Matthew 25. Okay? Here we go. "Again, it will be like a man going on a journey," and the "it" that he's talking about there is the kingdom of God. "The kingdom of God will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole, and hid the money in the ground, hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. 'Master,' he said, 'you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more.' His master replied, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with two bags of gold also came. Master, he said, you entrusted me with two bags of gold. See, I have gained two more. His master replied, and these are exactly the same words as he said to the guy with the five bags of gold. Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. And now the tension. Then the man who had received one bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gathered where I have not scattered seed. Well, then you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. So take the gold from him and give it to the one who has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Kay, this is supposed to make us not afraid? That sounds kind of scary. There are a couple of parts in this story that actually seem a little bit unfair. I mean, it appears that the master did not tell the servants that they were going to be measured or how they were going to be measured. It's not like he said, okay, here, guys, here are the metrics I'm going to use to assess your performance when I get back. He just gave them the gold, but he held them accountable anyway. And then there's that really negative ending. Everyone who has will be given more. And whoever does not have, even what you have will be taken. That sounds like robbing the poor to give to the rich. In fact, if this story is supposed to help us deal with fear, that is not a very good start. So let's talk about it. First, this is one of several stories that Jesus tells to teach us how to be ready for his second coming. In this story, he's like the master who goes away for a long time, and that represents Jesus. The servants are those like us who live between the time he goes away and the time he comes back, and he is coming back. And as the story indicates, we will be held accountable for how we lived while he was gone. Now, in the story, the master is obviously extremely wealthy. He has liquid assets that in today's dollars would put him among the massively wealthy. He gives his servants enormous sums of money to take care of while he's gone. The NIV calls them bags of gold. You may remember from when you were a kid or from reading one of the older translations, even the older New International Version or the King James or the New American Standard or one of the older versions, these were called talents of gold. A talent is a unit of measure, roughly 75 pounds. So five talents or five bags of gold would equal 375 pounds of gold. On last Monday, gold was trading around $1,300 an ounce. Five talents or 375 pounds of gold is in the range of $7.8 million. One servant was given almost $8 million of gold to manage. A second servant was given around $3.1 million. The third one was given around $1.5 million. Okay, so it's obvious that these guys are not just the butler, the chauffeur, and the chef. These are not the guys who kept the chariot waxed or the oil in the horses changed. These are the master's senior management team. He is turning over his portfolio to senior managers. They knew exactly what was expected. That's why the first two went right to work. And that also explains why the master would take the one bag of gold, that $1.3 million worth, from the bad manager and give it to the one who had been more productive. He's not taking what little the poor guy has and giving it to the rich guy. He's firing a financial advisor who didn't do good work. I mean, if you had somebody that you had entrusted a lot of money to, and you met with them, and they said, "We haven't gained anything," would you be okay with that? Of course not. We want, if we're going to put our money to work, we want it to work with somebody that's going to help it to grow. So this is not a situation where Jesus is celebrating taking from those who have and taking from those who don't have and giving to those who do have. In fact, in the very next story in Matthew chapter 25, he condemns people who do not take care of the poor, and he rewards those who do. But here's the thing I want us to focus on. I think we really need to focus on this. Why did the third member of the master's senior management team do such a crummy job of managing his master's resources? It's in verse 25. He says it. I was afraid. I was afraid. Couple of things here. First, I don't want you to get the idea that any and all fear is bad or faithless or a sign of spiritual defect. Fear in limited doses and in some situations is a very good thing. It's a great motivator. A little bit of fear in a potentially dangerous situation is good. A couple of weeks ago, Lisa and I were walking our dogs. We have two dogs. One is 80 pounds and one is about 16 pounds. Walking our dogs near the greenway. I saw something ahead of us on the path. Something long and thick and decorated with a diamond pattern. It was a snake, and I kid you not, it was as big around as my arm. And I could only see about 3 feet of it because the other 15 feet were slithering into the bushes. And behold, I was sore afraid. If it does not have legs but does have fangs, it is wise and godly to fear it. Even my dogs, with their limited capacity for rational thought, chose to give this satanic manifestation a wide berth. Fear's a good thing. You want to get rid of me? You want to, if you don't want the weirdness of all that, just become a snake handling church. I'm gone. I am so gone. I'll do aardvarks, I'll do duckbill platypi, I'll do wild animals of any kind, but I will not do snakes, ever. Fear is not always a bad thing, but fear is a terrible way to live. And here's where my heart really goes out to some of us, because some of us were raised in a home that instilled fear. And some of us work in a company that instills fear. And some of us grew up in churches that were all about fear, and it is a terrible way to live. If you're a boss or a manager and you think it's good policy to motivate your people with nothing but fear, you're wrong. If your spouse is apprehensive about who's going to walk in the door at the end of the day, your home is not a fortress, it's an asylum. If your go-to strategy for parenting is to strike fear in the hearts of your children, you're not raising obedient kids or disciplined kids, you're raising anxious kids. Fear is a terrible way to live. There's a reason why almost every time Jesus surprised his disciples or an angel showed up, the first thing they said was, "Be not afraid." There's a reason why Paul told Timothy that God did not give us a spirit of fear. Fear is good for getting us out of danger. Fear is an awful way to live your life. But there's a second thing here in this story that I think we need to hear. Back in verse 24, The third servant says some pretty harsh things about the master. Basically, he says, you're a hard man, you're unfair, you take what's not yours, and your expectations are completely unrealistic. He had a pretty low estimate of his master. Said this some weeks ago, early on in this series. Everything in our faith goes back to our image of God. If your image of God is wrong, your relationship with God is going to be weak. It's going to be shallow. I think it was William Willimon, former dean of the chapel at Duke University, who once met with a student who said he didn't believe in God. And Willimon said, tell me about the God you don't believe in. Chances are, I don't believe in that God either. What we believe to be true is enormously important because we live out of what we believe. If you believe that God is hard and scary and unfair and unjust and unpleasable, then you're going to live at a distance from that God. This was really driven home to me a few years ago. I blogged about this weekend. I took a mission trip to a city in Siberia called Novosibirsk. It was February. I'm sure you've been cold before. You have not been February in Siberia cold. Brutal. From Atlanta to New York to Frankfurt to Moscow, and then to our final destination to Novosibirsk. And every time we changed planes, I noticed something about the planes. The condition of the equipment we were flying diminished. Like the Atlanta plane was clean and shiny and still had that new plane smell. And then we picked up a really good certified pre-owned model in New York. And then we flew a decent 1990s model out of Frankfurt. Wasn't well appointed, but it felt safe. The plane we took from Moscow to Novosibirsk, though, not anything like it. I've flown in stunt planes before where we did all kind of crazy stuff. I've never been on an airplane like this. It looked angry. It looked mean. It looked like it was very disappointed in you personally. We didn't walk down one of those enclosed concourses. We took a bus out to the and climbed up a ladder to get on it. When you walk down the center aisle, the floor gave beneath your feet. It cranked, and then it flew, but it was just really scary. And I tried to sleep, but I couldn't. There was a girl next to me. Well, there was an empty seat next to me and then a window seat. And the window seat, this girl over here, fidgeted for 2 hours, a four-hour flight. For 2 hours of the flight, she fidgeted and moved and fought with her seat and just couldn't get comfortable. Finally, she looked at me in very good English, but Russian accented. She looked at me and she said, do you mind if I sit in the seat next to you? It's cold over here. There's a draft by the window. And I said, sure. But I was thinking, why is there a draft by the window? I'm not an avionics expert, but we're like 30,000 feet in the air flying along the border of Kazakhstan over frozen tundra. Not be a draft. But she moved over and I gave her my coat and I said to her, you should have asked me sooner. Why didn't you ask sooner? And here's what she said. She said, where I'm from, people do not help other people. And so you do not ask. And I said, I'm so sorry. That's an awful way to live. She said, it is an awful way to live. She said, I was just in New York, and people were so nice. And I said, really? You should come down south sometime. Wow. But here, you see what's going on there, right? She had this belief system. She believed a certain thing, that there's a guy sitting there, and he's got a coat, and there's a seat next to him, and I could ask to move over. No, and then I'll be cold and angry. So because of what she believed, she would not improve her circumstance. I think we do that with God. I think that's exactly what the servant did in Jesus' story. He had this view of his master. completely wrong. He was afraid and the fear froze him. And I think that happens with us and God. Some of us. Some of us because we were raised in a home that ran on fear. Some of us because the things we were taught in our church. And sometimes it's because we make incorrect conclusions. We're afraid of God. Our image of God is that he's slow to forgive and quick to judge and hard to please and easy to offend and actually takes pleasure in punishing people who fail, and so we dare not even try. I love the image that Mike painted for us earlier in the Lord's Supper about the Father and how he's willing to risk shame and dishonor to reclaim the relationship with us. That's a beautiful image. Look, your efforts, mine, at spiritual success, spiritual depth, may be as artless as a child's incomprehensible crayon drawing. But what do loving parents do with those rude little offerings? Put them on the refrigerator, and they stay there for months. Sometimes we even frame them and hang them on the wall. I've got a picture in my house that one of my kids drew. It's a painting of Pinocchio being eaten by a killer whale. That's not a part of literature anywhere. And it doesn't look all that artsy. But it is framed and hanging on my wall because one of my kids painted it. And then when our children grow up and move away, we treasure those little tributes. Not for their quality. We cherish them because they came from our children, whom we love, like God loves us. You don't need to be afraid of God. You just close your eyes for just a second. I want you to close your eyes. I want you to imagine God's kitchen in heaven. Can you even begin to go there with me? Just imagine God's kitchen in heaven. And there's God's refrigerator. And God's refrigerator is covered with crude little attempts at creative spiritual depth. But to him, every one of them is a masterpiece because they came from his sons and his daughters. That's the God we're trying to go deeper with. The story in Matthew 25 is ultimately about the return of Jesus. And that's another thing you don't have to. You and I are as guilty can be. We are sinners. We are separated from God by our sin. But God loved us so much, even in our sin, that he came here himself in the person of Jesus, and took the punishment that had our name on it. And if you and I will put our trust in what God did at the cross, God will take the righteousness, the rightness that has Jesus' name on it, and give it to us. That's a good God. That's a God you can go deep with. Let's pray together. Holy Father, forgive us when we fail to know who you are. You know good and well that our minds are limited and we can't go all the way into complete understanding of you, but we can try to see you as you revealed yourself to us through your word, through your creation, through Jesus. Help us to see you rightly, to worship you for who you are, and to realize that you love us and are full of mercy and grace. Father, forgive us when we've been wrong. Teach us to know who you are and to go deeper and to not be afraid of the God who died for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, Delbert Williams is going to lead us in a closing prayer here in just a minute. Delbert, if you could come on down. I want to recognize somebody that is with us this morning. Emery Cardenas is G. Todd and Anita Daniels' son. He is up here. Where are you? He's right up here. Emery, stand up. Can you see him? He's in the balcony. Hey, balcony folks. Right up here. Emery is leaving tomorrow He is in the Air Force. He's going to be stationed in Omaha, and he's going to become a refueling pilot. Let's give this airman a hand. Welcome. You be safe. You be safe. Glad you're here, Emery. Also tonight at 5 o'clock in this room, the spring is going to happen. That's our instrumental service. We'll be meeting and praising the Lord. Hope you'll come and be a part of that. Thank you so much for being here today. God bless you to be courageous this week in your walk with God. Delbert, come on up. Lead us in a prayer. Let's all go ahead and stand as Delbert comes up to lead us.
It has been so good to be here. Thank you, Jody. Appreciate you and Lisa and your ministry here. Lincoln and Mike Thomason, that does such a good job that we don't acknowledge that enough. Pray with me. Our divine Father in heaven, we're so blessed. We're so thankful for this church. Outreach, for the ministry, for our shepherds, for our staff, particularly for Jody and Lisa. We pray that you would give all of them good health, that they might continue to be blessed and bless us. As we think about the fear that we have, we pray that you would lead us away from that fear that's not good for us, and lead us in the paths that we should go to others. We pray that your Spirit will be with us this week, that we may increase our relationship with others, that we may love them. We thank you so much that we have this country that we can live in, where we have the opportunities that we do have. We pray now that you would continue to bless us, forgive us for our sins. We ask this in Christ's name.